If you've watched my videos before, you'll know that I'm a fan of low-carb diets, having lost 30 kilograms in 2016 to reverse my own obesity. So you probably think I'm going to say yes, of course carbs cause weight gain. Wouldn't it be nice if it was that simple? The notion that carbs cause weight gain seems to fall pretty fast when you speak to somebody who regularly eats giant bowls of pasta whilst remaining stick thin. And I think we all know someone like that. So if it's not the carbs that make us fat, then it must be eating too many calories, right? In that case, it's just a case of creating a calorie deficit and you'll lose weight. But if eating less and moving more worked as advertised, weight loss would be easy and we wouldn't have an obesity epidemic. So which is correct? Well, there have been some recent developments in this area which help shed some light on the issue. So let's find out. The debate over what causes weight gain has raged for years. There are two main theories about why we gain weight, and both suggest different solutions to how we should be going about losing weight. The first is the energy balance model, which states if you eat more calories than you burn, you'll gain weight, irrespective of where those calories come from. The second is the carbohydrate insulin model, which says no, the source of those calories is important, and the consumption of carbohydrates is the primary driver of weight gain, aka carbs make you fat. We're going to look at both of these in this video, but I want to stress one thing from the outset. Neither attempts to fully explain weight gain. Many other factors may also contribute. For example, education levels, food literacy, media consumption, exposure to food advertising, social pressures to consume various foods, the social acceptability of obesity, levels of employment, female employment, the type of employment, and a tendency towards increasingly sedentary jobs, cost of food ingredients, cooking skills, perceived lack of time for cooking, the availability of convenience food, smoking rates, alcohol consumption, levels of recreational activity, peer pressure, the use of medication, stress, emotional eating, access to opportunities to exercise, the cost of physical exercise, genetics, and breastfeeding, to name just a few. We're talking about the central premise here. For example, here is the British obesity system map, which attempts to piece all these different factors together. It's complicated, right? But it has energy balance at the center of all these other factors listed contributing to it. But at no point mentions the impact of dietary carbohydrate consumption. The carbohydrate insulin model wouldn't eliminate all that other stuff around the outside. It would just replace the middle bit. So we're talking about the central premise today, not every single factor. Let's start by looking at the energy balance model. You're probably very familiar with this, as it's the one that has been dominating the public health message for many years now. It states that a calorie is a calorie, and excess calories will cause weight gain, regardless of whether those calories come from proteins, fats, carbohydrates, or alcohol. The energy balance model implies that overconsumption of highly processed, energy-dense foods is the cause of obesity, as well as people living increasingly sedentary lives. It suggests that all you need to do to lose weight is create a calorie deficit by simply eating less and moving more. Suppose it was this simple. Indeed, obesity should have been an easy condition to cure. Unfortunately, rates of successful weight loss through calorie restriction are shockingly low. If you've ever been obese or overweight, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever managed to maintain weight loss beyond 3 months by calorie restriction alone? I'm going to pin a comment at the top of the comment section. Just take a second to answer yes or no. It's not exactly a scientific survey, but I'd be willing to bet that there will be more no's than yeses. The public health message that we need to eat less and move more has been a catastrophic failure, as evidenced by the increasing levels of obesity. Typically, a calorie-restricted diet is low fat because gram for gram, fat contains more calories than carbohydrates. Therefore, we can consume a larger quantity of food for fewer calories. And this message has been supported ever since the introduction of the low-fat dietary guidelines in the 1970s. Yet in the most extensive long-term study of its type ever completed, nearly 20,000 women assigned to a low-fat diet for 7.5 years lost less than 0.4 kilograms. That's not even a pound. And here's the thing. We all know that calorie restriction works initially, but after a few weeks, your body fights back. The energy balance model fails to consider that your body senses it's being calorie restricted, and it mounts a response. The hormones that control your hunger start to increase, and you begin to feel more hungry. Your metabolism starts to slow down, and so you conserve energy. It gets harder and harder to stick to the eating plan or to go out for that run, and you probably feel miserable and starving. The energy balance model makes weight gain and loss a physics problem, energy in and energy out, and fails to address the biology of how our bodies actually work. The worst thing about the energy balance model is that it puts the responsibility for failure back onto the individual. It says that it's your fault if you fail to lose weight. You should have managed to cut your calories more. You should have exercised more. You lack willpower. So why does this message persist? I love this quote by Henry Mencken. There's always a well-known solution to every human problem, neat, plausible and wrong. And I really think that applies here. Firstly, I think that public health organizations love to give out a simple message and they don't come much more straightforward than eat less, move more. Secondly, because many of us have experienced that it works in the short term, we have this instinct that it must be true. It's easier to blame our willpower than to challenge the status quo. But perhaps more cynically, it's a message that suits fast food and soft drinks brands because it says you can eat what you want as long as you exercise enough. It puts the responsibility on the individual and takes it off the corporations. Brands have spent billions promoting this message through clever marketing campaigns, such as associating their products with major sporting events. They've also sponsored scientists to push this message in the scientific literature and to sit on boards that decide public health policy. Follow the money. Now let's look at the alternative, the carbohydrate insulin model. The carbohydrate insulin model of weight gain suggests that over-consuming foods high in carbohydrates, especially those that the body absorbs rapidly, causes fat storage. It suggests that the reason for this is that carbohydrate consumption stimulates insulin production by the pancreas. This signals to our fat cells to take up whatever glucose is not immediately required for energy from the bloodstream and turn it into fat. Already we can start to see how this is more aligned with how our bodies actually work, and we have numerous examples showing the effect of insulin on weight gain. When we start someone on insulin injections for diabetes, one of the significant side effects is weight gain. Similarly, whenever we prescribe medications that stimulate the body to produce more insulin, they result in weight gain. Occasionally, people develop tumors that secrete insulin, called insulinomas, which cause weight gain. And then if we look at it from completely the opposite angle, in type 1 diabetes, when the pancreas suddenly stops producing insulin, patients present with rapid weight loss. All of these examples highlight the important role that insulin plays in promoting weight gain. It suggests that the solution to the issue of obesity is to restrict the intake of carbohydrates. This low-carb diet results in lower insulin levels and creates conditions in the body where we can lose weight. And it works. It's worked for me, it's worked for my clients, but more importantly, we've got loads of high-quality scientific evidence showing that low-carb diets are superior to low-fat diets. There is a complete list of all these studies on the Public Health Collaboration website if you'd like to go and look at them for yourself. So why isn't this routinely accepted as the status quo? Even though it makes a lot more sense and is more aligned with our biology than simply restricting calories, people frequently criticize this way of thinking about weight gain and weight loss. Well, on the face of it, there are a few problems. There are numerous examples of populations with high white rice consumption, yet low levels of obesity. This is known as the Asian paradox. These populations are frequently used as a reason why the carbohydrate insulin model must be false. So why do these populations usually have relatively low levels of obesity? There are multiple different interpretations of this. Remember, many different factors can impact obesity levels. These populations are typically subsistence farming societies with exceptionally high physical activity levels. This may offset the impact of high carbohydrate consumption. Additionally, there have been plenty of studies which have compared high carb diets against low-carb diets, which show that when you correct for calories, there's no difference in weight loss. These studies are fascinating, and I always have people in the comments of my videos who roll out these studies to justify why low-carb diets are not superior. But the vital thing to remember is that these are calorie-controlled studies. What these studies don't tell us is the effect on our appetite. In the real world, we're not controlling for calories as we do in scientific feeding studies. Because they control for calories, these studies fail to understand that low-carb diets have a significant effects on hunger. Ghrelin is a hormone produced primarily in the stomach, which signals to our brains that we're hungry. Ghrelin levels are significantly lower in those on low carbohydrate diets. Similarly, leptin, a hormone produced by our fat cells, is also found to be lower in those on low carbohydrate diets, suggesting an improvement in sensitivity to this hormone. Then we have very low carb or ketogenic diets where the body begins to produce ketones. This alternative fuel source may inhibit appetite directly. The experience of myself and many others is that they're less hungry when on low carb diets and therefore naturally calorie restrict. Because we have low insulin levels, our fat stores can give up their energy between meals like they're supposed to. People often drop from 3 meals a day plus snacks to 2 or even 1 meal a day simply because they're less hungry. This is a game changer. And yes, there are several other criticisms of the carbohydrate insulin model, which I'm not going to go into in this video because they're very academic. But if you'd like to learn more, I will point you in the direction of a fantastic review article by Dr. David Ludwig. David is a professor of nutrition at the Harvard School of Public Health. He authored a very detailed 2021 review in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition that addresses these concerns. So for those of you who want to dig deeper on this topic, I'll put that link in the description, along with all the other references that support what I'm saying in this video. The carbohydrate insulin model, by its very name, mainly looks at the role of glucose in triggering an insulin response. But glucose isn't the only carbohydrate we consume. We need to look much more closely at the impact of fructose, aka the fruit sugar here, because it helps us to explain some of the shortcomings in the carbohydrate insulin model that I mentioned earlier. For many thousands of years, humans consumed fructose amounting to between 16 and 20 grams daily, mainly from fresh fruits. More recently, westernization of diets has resulted in significant increases in added fructose, leading to typical daily consumptions of 85 to 100 grams. This represents a five-fold increase in what we used to consume. Most of that has come from added sugar in the form of sucrose, aka table sugar, and high fructose corn syrup, but also fruit juices and smoothies. Sugar is everywhere these days. Sweet foods and many apparently savory processed foods contain a surprisingly large amount of sugar too. Crucially, that big bowl of pasta that your friend can eat without gaining weight contains starches. The same thing is true for that white rice in the Asian paradox example. Starches are broken down by our digestive system to glucose, but not fructose. Crucially, sugar provides us with large amounts of both glucose and fructose in a form which is rapidly absorbed by our bodies. The energy balance model suggests that sugar causes weight gain simply because of the empty calories that it provides. But that doesn't fit in with our understanding of how sugar actually impacts our bodies. We've learned a lot about this in the last decade. Firstly, we must understand that fructose is metabolized differently from glucose. The whole body can metabolize glucose. In contrast, fructose is almost exclusively metabolized in the liver, where it's turned mainly into fat. The fat that we make in our livers from fructose tends to be stored around our abdominal organs, which is very harmful and strongly associated with heart disease. Continued fructose consumption overwhelms the ability of the liver to export that fat that it makes, leading to fat becoming trapped within the liver. This is a condition known as fatty liver disease. We know that 70% of overweight people and 75% of people with obesity have fatty liver disease. A liver with fat stored in it is unhappy and responds by becoming insulin resistant. Insulin resistance is when our bodies don't respond properly to the hormone insulin. Our cells need more than the usual amount of insulin to get the same response as before. Therefore, a key feature of insulin resistance is persistently elevated levels of insulin. We've already looked at the role that insulin plays in weight gain, and now we find ourselves in a situation where we've got a lot more insulin within our bodies. These elevated insulin levels keep our bodies in fat storage mode, so any carbohydrate intake from our diet is readily stored as fat. Insulin levels remain elevated between meals when they should be low. This means we can't access our stored fat for energy like we should be able to. Excess fructose has started the problem, but once insulin resistance is established, we have issues processing glucose too. Over time, the problem can become so severe that no matter how much insulin you produce, your body can't control your blood glucose levels. They start to climb and cause damage. That's type 2 diabetes. And you might ask, why have we suddenly started talking about type 2 diabetes? This is a video about whether carbohydrates cause us to gain weight. Well, that's the point. Insulin resistance underpins both of these diseases. They're on the same spectrum. Some people even call them diabesity. So the question I set out to answer at the beginning of this is, do carbs make you fat? When we're metabolically healthy, carbohydrate consumption doesn't typically cause weight gain. This is typically when we're young, active, and healthy, when our bodies haven't developed insulin resistance. Insulin is working as it's supposed to. It surges up after a carbohydrate-based meal, then drops back down, allowing our bodies to access stored fat between meals. In the beginning, I mentioned that person who can seemingly frequently eat large bowls of pasta without gaining weight. Well, they almost certainly haven't developed insulin resistance at that point. In those with healthy metabolisms, calories in versus calories out appears to work as advertised. But unfortunately, in the modern world, that doesn't last for long. The amount of fructose we're consuming from sugar eventually takes its toll on our metabolism, and we develop insulin resistance. For those who are already metabolically unhealthy, and that's the overwhelming majority of adults and an ever-increasing number of children. The development of insulin resistance means that carbohydrates will cause weight gain as we effectively become intolerant to them. Essentially, the more metabolically sick we get, the more the impact of carbohydrates on our bodies becomes apparent. And we are sick. It's estimated that 75% of adults in the USA are metabolically unhealthy. Here in the UK, 75% of adults over 45 are overweight, and 500 million people have diabetes, including in China. Remember we talked about the Asian paradox? Well, things have significantly changed over the last few decades. In modern day China, there is an epidemic of obesity and diabetes caused by a significant westernization of the diet. So for me, the carbohydrate insulin model represents a much better explanation of why we gain weight than the energy balance model, especially when we consider the negative impacts of fructose from excess sugar. Importantly, we've got a ton of evidence that low carbohydrate diets work, which is why I'm such a big advocate of them. But the other thing that is consistently shown to improve people's weight loss results is getting proper support when trying to implement these changes. It's one thing knowing which hill you need to climb up, it's another thing actually climbing up it. I've been helping people with this since 2016, and I've come to realize that there is more to this lifestyle than simply cutting carbs. It's why I run a support program called the Carb Dodging Challenge every few months. In this 8-week program, we support you through all the aspects of implementing this in your life so you can get off to the best start possible. I'm delighted to share that our clients consistently get amazing results. If you'd like to learn more about it, please visit carbdodging.com/challenge. I'll leave a link to that in the description. Thank you for watching this video. If you found it helpful, please give it a thumbs up. If you think this video could help someone that you know, I'd appreciate it if you shared it with them. If you'd like to see more of my videos, then make sure you subscribe to my channel, and hopefully I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.